nephew is at Spartanburg Hospital. Also, be in prayer for Wani's Aaron's son, Stan Aaron. He's been on our list for a long time. He has cancer, and his cancer has moved to his bones. So please be in prayer for Stan during this time. Also, continue to pray for Betty Lou Pound. And then also Dot and Bo Reynolds. Please continue to lift them up in your prayers. I've got William Guy on here. He's here tonight. I think he got some shots today. And so please continue to pray for him. I think this is the second round of shots that he's gotten. So please pray that those shots will start to work so that he will be alleviated of his pain. Also, Jackie Johnson. I don't see Dwayne and Jackie tonight, but please pray for Jackie as she continues to recuperate. You might remember she got out of the hospital last week. Just continue to pray for her. And then also the family of Leanne Williams. Leanne Williams is a member here. Her son passed away last week, and so if you'd like to minister to that family, they're having a visitation this coming Sunday at Barr Price Funeral Home in Lexington from 3 to 5. Also, please be in prayer for a young lady by the name of Kristen Austin. That is Ryan Risch's girlfriend, and Ryan Risch is Tracy Risch's son. So please be in prayer for them. Several announcements that I need to share with you very quickly. Want to remind you about this coming Sunday. So this coming Sunday, we have a lot going on. Let me go through that. And also, forgot to mention in prayer, keep praying for Daniel Chavis. I see you out there, Daniel. He had an accident Saturday night with a chainsaw. Chainsaw didn't win, though. Daniel's okay. But he got stitched up, and they sent him home. So please keep praying for Daniel with that. And the Lord's hand was on him during that for sure. Sunday morning, want to let you know we have a new members class that we're beginning. That is a five-week class for anybody that is interested in becoming a member of our church. I'm really thankful. We already have 15 people signed up for that class. And that's really surprising. Usually, the last class I had was 14. Usually, when you have one over 10, the next one's about 5 or 6, and then the next one's between 10 and 15. So this is back-to-back of 15. So we give God praise for that. So that's at 9:45, of course, Sunday school at like normal. And then I also want to let you know we're doing something really special. This is something we do every year. But at 4:30, I'm asking anybody that wants to come, and we're going to go out and we're going to pray for our schools. So we are praying for our 7 area schools. And we're also praying for our Lexington 4 district office. So we have 8 locations that we're going to be going to. So let me tell you how this is going to work. We're going to meet in here at 4:30. And then we're going to disperse out. So how is that going to work? We have prayer leaders at 8 of those places. We have people that we've asked to lead, and so we're also going to be handing out prayer cards. What's on those prayer cards? Well, if you get one of those cards, it tells you specifically what to pray for. Not just pray for at the school, but pray for when you get home, right? And so what we're going to do is we'll bring everybody in here. I'm hoping we have a lot of folks, because last year when we did this event, guys, we had 11 people. So we had 1 to 2 people going to each school, and people probably saw that, and we want to make sure that people see when we're praying for our schools that there's a lot of people that care about that school from First Baptist Gaston. And so what will happen is I know I'm leading a school, Pastor Chris is leading a school, Sherelle's leading a school, so when we come up, I'll say I don't remember what school I'm going to, but Francis Mack, right? And so if you are interested in going and praying at Francis Mack, you can just walk out with me and go to Francis Mack. And so we're going to have that at 4:30. We're going to leave right before 5, probably about 4:55, because I got to be in Batesburg by 6:30. So, we got to do that. So anyway, so 8 different schools, that's what we're going to do. So if you'd be interested in that, please be here at 4:30 to be able to do that. Also want to let you know, Family Fun Night is happening this coming Friday. I believe they're playing bingo, and the prizes that they're giving away are school supplies. So for all of our young families, make sure you're a part of that. Travis and Liz do a great job with this, so make sure you sign up for that. Please sign up for that. Also, last thing I'll leave you with, want to remind you, I sent an email about it a few weeks ago, but D groups, I think we have a graphic for you on that. Our D groups are going to be starting up from September the 10th to November the 5th.
And it's going to be every Sunday from 4 to 5 p.m. And October the 8th is like our fall break or whatever. So it goes 4 weeks, off a week, and then four more weeks. So you say, what are D groups? That stands for discipleship groups. So what we're doing is actually on August the 13th, you'll be able to sign up for a D group. But we are introducing, this is the first time we've done this, we're introducing six different classes, discipleship classes that you can take from 4 to 5 p.m. We're doing 8 weeks in the fall and 8 weeks in the spring. And so you can take a new D group in the spring. So you say, what kind of D groups are there? Well, there are six of them. The first one, Pastor Chris, is teaching a new believers D group. Charles Burton is teaching an apologetics D group. Lauren Cantrell is teaching a ladies Bible study D group. My wife, Hannah, is teaching a youth girls Bible study D group. Lee Sanford is teaching a children's D group, so we have a children's D group. And then I'm teaching a biblical hermeneutics D group, which is a seminary-level course. Actually, Southwestern Seminary allows us to use their curriculum for our biblical hermeneutics D group. So if you'd be interested in taking a D group, I highly suggest you do that. I really think after Pastor Chris and I have prayed about it a lot, we feel like one of the needs in our church and one of the needs in 99% of churches is discipleship. And so we're hoping that these D groups will be able to help us with that. So I hope you're excited. I haven't got a lot of feedback yet about excitement, so I hope you're excited about that and how we think God's going to use that. Any prayer? Yes, William. Yep. So Good News Club is out sharing the news. Any prayer requests? Yes. Okay. Oh, okay. Okay. Pray for Paul Allen. Okay. Ernest? Okay. Okay. All right. Anybody else? All right. Father God, we want to thank you and praise you, Lord, for the opportunity we have to just come and to worship you tonight. Lord, for all of these requests that were mentioned, Father, we know you're the great physician. We know you're the great healer. And we know that you hear us when we call out to you. Lord, I just lift up all these different things, Lord, from Paul Allen to Ernest Gant's son-in-law. I just pray that you be with each of these situations, Lord. And I just ask, Father, that you would be glorified and honored in all of them. Please move in our worship service tonight. Forgive us of our sins for where we fail you. In Jesus' name, and all God's people said.
I bring my praise before I bring my need. 'Cause there's no fear you've not already seen. I rest my heart on all your promises. 'Cause I have seen and know your faithfulness. You're parting waters, making a way for me. You're moving mountains that I don't even see. You've answered my prayer before I even speak. All you need for me to be is still and know that you are God. Be still and know that you trust that you are parting waters. Lord, you whispered my name. Ooh.
That. All right. Well, we're going to be in the book of Hebrews tonight. We're continuing our verse-by-verse series. I would say I promise you, but I'll just say we're going to try to be done with this series by October. That's the goal. So we won't be in Hebrews too much longer. So if you have a copy of God's Word, we're going to find ourselves in Hebrews chapter 12, verses 3 through 11 in just a moment. Last Wednesday, we had missionaries Tim and Margaret Barr that were here to talk about their experience in India, and I know many of you enjoyed them. So it was 2 weeks since we've been in Hebrews, and the last time we were here, I preached from Hebrews chapter 12, verses 1 through 2, and I preached a message entitled, Run the Race. And I asked the question, how can we keep running the race that God has set before us? And in that message, we looked at learning from the witnesses, let go of the world, and look to the winner. And so if you missed that message, you can go online and watch that. But if you were here a few weeks ago, I want to ask you, based on that sermon, are you running the race? And if you are, how well are you running the race? And then the other question I'll ask you is, are you running for His glory? And His glory alone. Tonight I want to speak to you on a difficult message, a difficult topic. I tell you what, if you're here this evening and you were also here Sunday morning, if you left Sunday morning, I don't know how anybody could leave Sunday morning without being a believer in Christ, the way that Pastor Zach delivered the message and preached on salvation. What an incredible message. If you haven't watched that, please do. I'm surprised y'all even let me back. I mean, I was just shocked. I mean, Pastor Zach was incredible. But I'm going to preach a very difficult message tonight on being thankful for the discipline of God. Being thankful for the discipline of God. And tonight's sermon in a sentence is this. We can be thankful for the discipline of God in our lives, and we see our need for discipline, struggle when we neglect discipline, and should symbolize natural discipline that God intended for our lives. You might remember earlier this year, we did a 5-week sermon series that was called Family Fatalities. And in that series, discipline came up a lot, right? And the Lord laid that series on my heart so that many of the young families in our church that have children would know how important it is to not make the wrong fatalities in their family. And what came up a lot in that series was discipline and children. Right? Disciplining your children. How do you do that? Why is it biblical? Why should we discipline our children? And I was so shocked during that sermon series how many young families came up to me and said, I didn't even understand what the Bible said about discipline. Thank you for teaching what the Bible says on how we should discipline our kids. And then as I started preparing for this message, it reminded me of my preparation for that series. Because in a similar way, a lot of parents might not realize how or why or all that with discipline with their kids, but many Christians don't understand that God has the right to discipline you and He has the right to discipline me. But as soon as God begins that process in us, we turn into that four-year-old kid that says, "No, I didn't do anything." Or we turn into that eight-year-old that says, "He did it." And so many Christians that have been Christians a long time don't understand the discipline of God. And if they do understand it, how many of us are actually thankful for the discipline of God? When we've had Thanksgiving services, and sometimes on Wednesday nights, some of y'all might remember when I first came, we used to have a time, and maybe we need to do it again sometime, but we would go through the room and talk about what we were thankful for. And y'all remember Ronnie Sharp used to always say, you know, he was thankful for the Lord and for Jesus. But I've never heard anybody say they were thankful for the discipline of God. I've heard people say they were thankful for the food they had, their marriage, their children, all these things. But we live in a society where instead of being thankful for the discipline of God, we are taught to view discipline as disrespect. When in reality, that is not how God designed discipline to be. Discipline is not disrespect. Discipline is love. If you love your child, you will discipline them. And I know this isn't directed towards parents, but if you do have a child and you don't discipline your child, that's not loving them. God didn't call you to be your child's BFF, right? He called you to be their parent. Similar to how when some of us were children, when God disciplines us, He is showing us that He loves us. In Hebrews chapter 3, verses 3 through 11, I think we're going to find that word discipline found a lot throughout it. And that word discipline, I just want to do a word study on the front end of tonight's message. That word discipline, depending on your translation, if you have the King James, it's going to say chastisement, right? So discipline in the ESV, chastisement in the King James, depending on your translation. But either way, that word is coming from the Greek word paideia, and it literally means education, training of a child, or child training, instruction, or discipline. So when that Greek word is used, it's talking about God educating you as His child. God training you as His child. See, what is so problematic about Christianity today is that when people come to accept Christ, and I was talking to a young lady today about this, she and her grandmother. But what happens a lot is people want to have Jesus in their life as Savior. But very, very few are willing to have Him as Lord. And if you're going to have a relationship with the Lord, and He's actually going to be your Lord, you actually have to be listening to Him and willing for Him to discipline you. But how many of us, and don't raise your hand, but how many of us are actually willing to be told that we're wrong? Or how many of us are actually willing to say, "Hey, I messed up"? Guys, I've had adults even in the church where I've said, "Hey, we need to do this better." "Oh, it wasn't me." No, I'm not trying to be rude to anybody, but if we want to improve as the body of Christ, when we do wrong, we need to be honest and say, "I did wrong," right? That's something that we need to be able to admit. What I want to remind you of is that the reason that Greek word paideia is used so much is the writer of Hebrews is using this word in a strategic sense. Because within the Greek culture, and see, none of us are Greek, so it's hard for us to understand this. But within the Greek culture, a young boy was expected to work out in the gym until he reached the age of his maturity. So in addition to his academic education, he was also expected to have a physical education, right? A physical time. I actually did a lot of research, and our modern day PE, physical education, originated from the Greeks causing mandatory exercise. Now, the Greeks' mandatory exercise was a whole lot more than an hour of PE, okay? A whole lot more rigorous than that. But in the Greek culture, physical fitness and exercise were a really big deal. And boys in the Greek culture were expected to do this in order to prepare for the different aspects and avenues that life would take them down. And in a similar way, the writer of Hebrews is viewing the trials and obstacles that we have in the Christian life, or as his metaphor in Hebrews 12 is, the race, right? The obstacles that come in our race as discipline from God that is meant to mature us and make us more like Him. And when I think of that, I think of that passage in Jeremiah that was made into a song, I am the potter and He is the clay. Or excuse me, I am the clay and He is the potter. But so many of us do what I just did and we turn it around. And we think we're the potter. But you're not. He is. So the writer of Hebrews wanted his readers, Jewish Christians, to know and understand that the discipline of God is something that should be present in our lives and something that we are thankful for. So if you have a copy of God's Word, and if you're physically able, if you would, please stand in honor of the reading of the Word of God. Consider Him who endured from sinners such hostility against Himself, so that you may not grow weary or faint-hearted. In your struggle against sin, you have not yet resisted to the point of shedding your blood. And have you forgotten the exhortation that addresses you as sons? My son, do not regard lightly the discipline of the Lord, nor be weary when reproved by Him. For the Lord disciplines the one He loves and chastises every son whom He receives. It is for discipline that you have to endure. God is treating you as sons. For what son is there whom his father does not discipline? If you are left without discipline in which all have participated, then you are illegitimate children and not sons. Besides this, we have had earthly fathers who disciplined us and we respected them. Shall we not much more be subject to the Father of spirits and live? For they disciplined us for a short time as it seemed best to them, but He disciplines us for our good, that we may share His holiness. For the moment, all discipline seems painful rather than pleasant, but later it yields the peaceful fruit of righteousness to those who have been trained by it. Father God, we thank You for Your Word. I pray, Lord, that You would teach us what we need to hear tonight, and if we need discipline, Lord, that You would discipline us and according to Your will. Lord, forgive us where we fail You, and Holy Spirit, please move in this worship service. In Jesus' name, all God's people said. If you will, please be seated. I want to ask you this question tonight. How can we be thankful for the discipline of God based on what we find in this passage? Number one, in order to be thankful for the discipline of God, number one, we need to see your need for discipline. How can you be thankful for the discipline of God if you don't first see your need for the discipline of God? Oftentimes when a child, whether it's your child or your grandchild, does something wrong and disobeys, they often do not think that they are wrong. Let me give you a newsflash. Most people don't think that they are wrong. I mean, you can say, hey, the sky's blue. They said, no, it's red. No, it's blue. Nope. And so we have this problem, right? We live in this kind of society. But see, that's why the Lord has implemented parents, teachers, family members, and adults in general to correct children and show them their need for discipline. And in the same way, guess what, adults? We don't outgrow discipline. Did you know that God can use other people in your life to discipline you? You might not like it, but He can use whatever He wants to discipline with you. With Jonah, He used a whale. But think about with King David, right? He brought the prophet Nathanael in, right? And Nathanael had to have a really hard conversation with the king, with David. And David didn't like what the prophet had to say, but God used him to bring that discipline. You need to see your need for that. Usually a child will usually repeat the same offense until they see their wrong and their need for correction. Oftentimes, when a child is disciplined, then they may see their need. In other words, my parent is taking this serious enough to take the time out of their busy schedule to discipline me, and the discipline might hurt, whether it's emotional hurt, physical hurt, whatever. Okay, this is serious. So I see my need there. One reason that the discipline of God is not discussed in pulpits today or even in Christian circles is because we don't see our need. This is a rhetorical question. Don't answer this out loud, but how many times do you hear preachers on TV preaching on the discipline of God? Or how many times do you hear sermons on discipline in general? You don't, because people don't want to hear that. But see, that's why verse-by-verse preaching is so important, is because you can't miss passages like this. It's easy to skip around if you're not going verse-by-verse. Let me remind you of Romans 3:23 that I think will show our need for discipline. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. So if you don't think you have a need, then you don't think you sin. Due to this disease that we call sin, even as a Christ follower, from time to time, God may need to discipline us and show us how wrong we were. And the more and the longer that you neglect discipline is probably the longer that you're going to be under discipline. It's like when you have a certain sin or a certain attitude that you're struggling with and that God is trying to refine and to change in you, the more you run from God, the more you're going to have struggle with getting that right with Him. I think it's hard to be thankful for something if you don't see the need, such as discipline. So I think there's three things we need to consider in order to see our need for discipline. Number one, looking in verse 3, we need to consider our need for the Savior. Look at verse 3. Consider Him who endured from sinners such hostility against Himself, so that you may not grow weary or faint-hearted. Now, verse 3 seems to connect a little bit more to verses 1 and 2 in Hebrews 12. I believe it can also be a reminder for us in the need for our Savior. The more that we reflect on what Jesus did for us on Calvary, the more that we see our need to worship and to bow down to Him. Right? Consider our need for the Savior. Look at verse 3. Consider Him who endured from sinners such hostility against Himself. Last time I checked, nobody in here has been beaten with a cat of nine tails 39 times. Now, I don't know that for a fact, but I'm pretty sure. But Jesus did, right? He endured this hostility that He was going through. Why? So that we may not grow weary or faint-hearted. Why did Jesus go through the cross? So that we would see our need for Him, get in the race, and then once we're in the race, meaning we're a believer, we continue in that race. Jesus didn't die so that you could live whatever kind of life you want to live. And Jesus didn't die, you know, God didn't become your spiritual father just so that you could just say, hey, give me what I want. God's going to give you what you need, and sometimes that is discipline. And so we need to come more accustomed to that. And let me just tell you something. I don't know why, but churches have some really haughty attitudes when it comes to discipline. You're telling me I did something wrong? I'm just telling you what God's Word says. No, you don't like me. I'm going to another church. I told you what God's Word says. If you don't like what God's Word says, you probably don't need to be here anyway, right? Because we should be falling in love with God's Word and what it says here. Christ went through what He did so that you can experience heaven, but also holiness here on earth. But we forget about the holiness part, and you don't become holy just because you work for it. You become holy because Christ is holy. And if you're going to be holy because Christ is holy, you need to be willing for God to discipline you. And for that to occur. Life with Jesus is not meant to be punishment. It's not meant to be confinement. But a joy ride with Him includes the Lord refining us the entire way. So that means that the discipline of God doesn't give out just because whether you're 8 years old or 80 years old, it continues on. Not only should we consider our need for the Savior, we also need to consider our own situation. Look at verses 4 and 5. In your struggle against sin, you have not yet resisted to the point of shedding your blood. And have you forgotten the exhortation that addresses you as sons? The recipients of this letter had surely faced persecution, not just from the Roman government, but also from their own Jewish circles, right? These are believers who had left Judaism, but a lot of them were trying to go back to Judaism. So they were facing a lot of persecution from that. But no amount of persecution is compared to the shedding blood that Jesus had to give in order for us to have salvation in Him. So no matter how hard you think your life is, and by the way, Christians in America have no idea what persecution even is. But if you think your persecution for the gospel is really bad, when was the last time you shed your blood for all of humanity? No, you can't do that because you're not perfect, because Jesus did something that you and I could never, ever, ever, ever do. So consider your situation. Consider, and I know you might not like this, but consider the fact that you are a finite human being. And yes, God loved you enough to send His Son to die for you, but guess what? You need to consider your situation. You have no other way to salvation except by Jesus Christ. So to try to work your way is a waste of time. Oliver Green said this: because of their profession of faith in Christ, the Hebrew Christians had suffered severely in many ways. They had been sorely oppressed and persecuted by their unbelieving Hebrew brethren, but they had not resisted unto blood. They had suffered, but they were alive. Jesus suffered unto blood, and Jesus died, spilling His blood. When we put our situation up against Jesus' sacrifice, we should walk away being thankful unto God. And when God disciplines you, you should be thankful. Consider your own situation. Thirdly, consider the Scriptures. Look at verses 5 through 6. My son, do not regard lightly the discipline of the Lord, nor be weary when reproved by Him. For the Lord disciplines the one He loves and chastises every son whom He receives. Now, if you're looking at that in your Bible, it should be in quotation marks. You know why? Because this is another instance where the writer of Hebrews has quoted the Old Testament. The New Testament book of Hebrews has more Old Testament quotations in it than any other New Testament book. So what does that mean? That means that the writer of Hebrews is trying to continue to build his argument. If you're making an argument or you're writing a research paper, what are you going to use? You're going to use sources, right? So he's using the Old Testament as his source. So what scripture is this? This is Proverbs chapter 3, verses 11 through 12. And it's another example of him pulling from that. So consider the scriptures. He's pulling that the scriptures also teach about discipline. So obviously, the author of Hebrews must have been a pretty good preacher because he's using God's word to prove his point, right? So consider the Savior, consider your situation, but consider the scriptures. If you don't like the discipline of God, God's word clearly teaches that, right? Not just that God disciplines us, but that we should discipline our children. Secondly tonight, and we're answering the question, how can we be thankful for the discipline of God? First, we looked at consider your own situation. Secondly, struggle if you neglect discipline. Now, I kind of struggled with this point a little bit. This one took me a little bit longer. Because if you make the conscious decision to neglect the discipline of God, then you need to accept the fact that you will struggle without His discipline your entire life. And you also need to accept the fact, and you need to investigate, am I truly a Christian if I constantly neglect the discipline of God? In other words, if the Holy Spirit keeps knocking on our heart saying, hey, you shouldn't be doing that. Hey, you shouldn't be watching that. Or maybe God uses a situation to discipline you or a person to discipline you, and you completely annihilate that person because they're trying to speak life into you and speak the word of God. You need to ask the question, do I really know the Lord? Because I really don't want Him to change me. So you're going to struggle your entire life if you neglect the discipline of God. And you're going to blame other people. And you're going to say, well, that church hurt my feelings. And that Sunday school teacher, they just weren't doing it the right way. No, maybe they were doing it the way God told them to in His word. You just didn't want to listen. Or you just didn't want to change. You will struggle if you neglect the discipline of God. Because many Christians have developed the mindset that they are too good or too holy for God to discipline them. You say, I didn't know that. I'll give you some scriptural examples of some folks that thought that. It is impossible to live the Christian life the way God intended it to if you neglect or negate the discipline of God. You will struggle all throughout your life. And there are many Christians that I love dearly that just can't handle the discipline of God. They just can't handle being told they did something wrong. Let me just tell you something. I hope she's not watching. But I grew up in a household. I was wrong, wrong, wrong all the time. And I actually was wrong. I'm not just saying. I really was. My mom was not afraid to tell me, you just messed up. You shouldn't have done that. You shouldn't have said that. Yes, ma'am. Let me go think about it. No, you pray about it. Right? I mean, I was told that. But see, we have a generation today where parents don't tell their children they're wrong anymore. And we live in a generation today where adults don't even tell adults, hey, you might not have just said it that way. Oh, well, they were mean to me. They hurt my feelings. Can we get over the phrase, hurt my feelings? Can we please get over that? I understand you have feelings. I get that. But we all need to do what my wife tells me to do and get over it. You know, sometimes I come home and maybe somebody hurt my feelings or they said something that was really rude, and I'll tell her at the dinner table and she'll say, "Get over it." "Yes, ma'am, I'll get over it." You just got to move on, right? Take it with a grain of salt. Let me give you some examples of some Christians in the Bible, Bible characters that tried to run away from God's discipline. We see that Jonah ran away from God's discipline. And what happened to him? He got swallowed up by a whale. Okay, what about Samson? Samson disobeyed God, and he was disciplined by being captured by the Philistines without his human strength. God disciplined him. He disobeyed, there was a consequence. What about Zechariah when he laughed at God, right? When he laughed at God, when he heard that he would have a son, so how did God discipline him? He silenced him because he laughed at God. If you neglect God's discipline, you will quickly find out that you are not God and you cannot escape his discipline no matter how hard you might try. So, what does the writer of Hebrews try to show us in verses 7 through 8 concerning discipline, the fact we will struggle if we neglect it? Look at verse 7. The first thing I think we see is that we see genuine children. Look at verse 7. "It is for discipline that you have to endure. God is treating you as sons, for what son is there whom his father does not discipline?" It is biblical that a parent will discipline their child. In the same way, the writer of Hebrews is explaining that the Lord disciplines those who are genuine children of God. If you are a genuine child of God and you constantly sin and you don't feel bad about it at all, you need to ask yourself, am I a genuine child of the King? Because if you are a genuine child of the King, you will be disciplined. And now you see why this is not a popular message. Because we don't like that. That's uncomfortable. Despite the cultural climate, when a parent disciplines their child, it shows that they are truly their parent. The role of a parent is to discipline and correct the path of their child when they go astray. That is the parent's obligation. That is their job. And uncomfortable or unsettling as that might be, it is true that this is the way that God intended it to be. When a parent chooses not to just discipline their child, it is not showing them love. I love the phrase tough love. I feel more love from tough love than I do whatever other kind of love you want to come up with. Because it shows that somebody's willing to talk to me about the hard things than they are the easy things. Let me give a leadership lesson here. If you're in any kind of leadership, whether it's pastoral leadership, you're leading in a business, you're leading in your home, you got to have people to be around you and to advise you. And the people that I try to keep close in my circle are not people that are going to say, "Yeah, that's a great idea," every single time. No, they're people that are going to say, "Hey, Brady, why don't you step back and see how it's going to affect this person? How's it going to affect that person?" And I've had some amazing people in this church give me great advice that might have been tough love, but I'm like, "Wow, that's great. I'm going to use that. I might not have agreed with it, but guess what? I felt like I needed to hear that." Just because somebody has a different opinion than you doesn't mean they don't like you. Have you ever thought that God is trying to use people in your life that you keep annihilating because you just don't like what they have to say? God might be using them to speak to you. So why are we shocked when the Lord disciplines us? Listen to me. We love to cry out to God as our Father when we're in distress or when we're in an uncomfortable situation. But do we still accept His loving hand as Father when we need correction? When God disciplines you, it is fruit that you are walking in Him and enduring in this life. When you're disciplined by God, that is evidence of your faith. Because God doesn't want you to stay the same. He wants you to continue to grow. Earlier in Hebrews, on several occasions, we know the writer discusses drifting from God and how some never got off the spiritual milk. They're still on the milk and not on to the meat. Here he shows that those who are true believers in Christ will be disciplined by God. The English word endure comes from the Greek word hypomeno, and it literally means to endure and suffer patiently and to continue firmly. This word is found in the Greek New Testament 17 times. And the writer of Hebrews uses it also in Hebrews 10:32 when we studied it. If God is truly your Father, then He will discipline you as one of His own children. So first we see, if we struggling to neglect discipline, first we see the fact of genuine children, but secondly, in verse 8, we see illegitimate children. Let's look at verse 8. If you are left without discipline, in which all have participated, then you are illegitimate children and not sons. Don't you love how the writer of Hebrews just puts it out there? Right? I mean, there is no sugarcoating here. There is no but or gray area. No, black or white. You're either a child of God or you're not. Have you ever heard the phrase before? And I hear it all the time at funerals and it just kind of makes me cringe. Well, we're all God's children anyway. Nope. That's not true. I think John chapter 1 is really clear. In order to be a child of God, you have to be born again, right? Born into the family of God. So we use all these phrases, right? Being born again. Oh, I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I guarantee you 85% of the people that sing as loud as they can, I'm so glad to be a part of the family of God, will sing in the bedroom, I'm so mad that God is trying to discipline me, right? As a child, if you want to be a part of the family of God, don't throw the baby out with the bathwater, right? You want the benefits, but you don't want the discipline. You will struggle all your life if you keep running from God's discipline. Think about how many of you are so thankful tonight for the mom and dad that God gave you and that they told you the truth even when it hurt. If you are without the discipline of God in your life, you really need to ask yourself, am I a child of God? You need to ask yourself, when I sin, is there conviction from the Holy Spirit? Now, let me remind you, and I've said this in several sermons, and we say this in the Good News Club all the time. When you sin, and what is sin? Anything that I do, say, or think, right, that goes against God. When you sin, do you feel bad and seek to repent and turn from your sin, or do you just keep on going? I hope that when you come to church, it's not the only time you pray. I hope that when you come to church, it's not the only time that Bible's open. If you opened your Bible to Hebrews 12 last night, it was still bookmarked in Acts chapter 2, verses 41 through 47, that might be a problem. You say, it's only been 3 days. How many of us would go 3 days without eating on purpose? So then why would we go 3 days without the Word? If you are not experiencing this, you need to genuinely reflect and ask yourself, am I a child of God? J. Vernon McGee gave this illustration. I thought it was really good, so I'm pulling this from J. Vernon McGee. There were several boys, and J. Vernon McGee was one of them. But anyway, there were several boys who were at school and got in trouble. And when J. Vernon McGee's father came to the school, he walked across the yard and took his son home and disciplined the young J. Vernon McGee. While there were hundreds of kids at the school that day and hundreds of kids running in the schoolyard, the father only took his son home. He disciplined him in love. Notice that J. Vernon McGee's father did not go and grab Billy or Jimmy or Wayne. No, he grabbed J. Vernon McGee. Why? Because that was his son. God is not going to discipline someone that is not his child. And we need to understand that. And the writer of Hebrews is literally saying that. So far tonight, we've studied that we need to see our need for discipline. We need to struggle, or we will struggle if we neglect discipline. But finally tonight, I want to show you the third and final point. Our lives need to symbolize natural discipline. Now, you might say, well, this is a really interesting point, preacher. Well, let's look at verses 9 through 11 for just a moment. Besides this, we have had earthly fathers who disciplined us, and we respected them. Shall we not much more be subject to the Father of spirits and live? For they disciplined us for a short time as it seemed best to them, but He disciplines us for our good, that way we may share His holiness. For the moment, all discipline seems painful rather than pleasant, but later it yields the peaceful fruit of righteousness to those who have been trained by it. Like many preachers, the writer of Hebrews realizes that an illustration is a really good way to prove a point. We know that the writer of Hebrews was wanting us to understand that our Heavenly Father disciplines us, or disciplines those that are truly His children that He loves. Whether we enjoy it or not, we know our Heavenly Father disciplines us because of His love. But we also need to be thankful for the discipline of God, for how it symbolizes is the nature of discipline that should be occurring in our homes. So what I'm trying to draw out from verses 9 through 11 is that God has showed us the order of discipline. God has showed us the example. We should follow that example in our lives and in our homes. Symbolize natural discipline. In other words, discipline. And I looked the week before when I was prepping for this. There's some really weird material about discipline out there. Non-Christian organizations have caused discipline to be this crazy thing that it's not. And if we really want to understand, if we really want to take our homes back in America, we will symbolize the natural discipline the way that God intended it to be. And the way that God disciplines us is the way parents should discipline their children and then their children's children, right? That's the way it should be. And I'm not telling you it had to be this way. But in the family I grew up in, okay, I came from a family of 9. My dad wasn't in the home. My mom was. My mom made a rule that whether it was her or my aunt or my uncle or my grandmother or my grandfather or my great-grandparents, any adult in the family had the right to discipline me, my sister, and all my cousins. It didn't matter if it wasn't my dad or what my mom, if they disciplined me, and that was it. It's not up for discussion. Now, you might not agree with that in your home, and that might not work in your home, but children should obey adults. As Christians should obey God. I mean, we all agree that children should obey an adult, but we don't all agree that we should obey God. You might say that you do, but does your life reflect that you do? Do you symbolize that natural order of discipline? Everything that God has set in place is for a reason. Whether we believe it or not, did you know that mosquitoes have a purpose? It's hard to see that, isn't it? I mean, those things hurt. But guess what? They're food for frogs and other animals and things. But in the Jewish culture, discipline was a very important part of any Jewish home. And parents were to teach and discipline their children. Of course, we know the writer of Hebrews was writing to Jewish Christians, so they would understand this analogy he's trying to give very well. Let me leave you with these two things. I believe there are two important aspects that we need to consider as we look at how the discipline of God symbolizes natural discipline. Number one, we all have earthly fathers. You might not have had a great experience with your dad. Your dad might not have been highly involved in your life or your mother or whatever the case is. But it doesn't take away the fact that everybody has a mom and everybody has a dad. That's how you got here. And if you don't understand that, we definitely need to talk later on. But we all have a mom and we all have a dad. And God has given us all earthly fathers. Now, I know that not everybody has those great experiences, but I want to remind you with what John Phillips stated in his commentary. Since we have had to submit to human chastising and have learned to respect our fathers because of their authority, how much more must we yield to God and hold Him in awe? Our earthly fathers should direct us to how amazing our Heavenly Father is. Now, you might have a great dad or you might not have a good dad. Whatever your case is, your Heavenly Father is a better father to you than your earthly father. Why? Because your earthly father was a human being. Your Heavenly Father is God Almighty. And He's perfect. So our earthly father should remind us of how amazing and incredible our Heavenly Father is. So instead of asking the question, or in other words, before asking questions like, why is this happening to me? Or why do I have to suffer? Or how can this ever be for my good? We should stop and thank God and say, I don't know why I'm going through this. I don't know if you're trying to test me or you're taking me through a trial. Or you might even be trying to discipline me. But thank you, God. What did James say in the beginning of his letter? Be thankful when you experience trials and tribulations of all kinds. And then in 1 Thessalonians 5:16, rejoice, right? Rejoice. Christians shouldn't be down and in the dumps and gloomy and oh, woe is me. No, you have the King of Kings as your Father. Get over it, right? I mean, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords is your Heavenly Father, and all you can do is mope around. You have more victory than that. That phrase, shall we not much more be subject to the Father's spirits and live? We need to investigate that. Many commentators and theologians will argue on what the phrase Father of Spirits means. There's all kind of stuff written about this. Instead of giving you all the different viewpoints and exhausting that list, I want to tell you what I think this is talking about. I believe the writer of Hebrews is talking about how heaven, not just earth, is subject to God, right? And so that He is the Father of the spiritual realm as well as the physical realm. In other words, God is the creator of it all, and He's in charge of that. To help us understand this, I think we need to see that the writer of Hebrews is probably pulling from Numbers chapter 16, verse 22. And they fell on their faces and said, O God, the God of the spirits of all flesh, shall one man sin, and will you be angry with all the congregation? And then in Numbers 27:16, let the Lord, the God of the spirits of all flesh, appoint a man over the congregation. The God of all spirits means the gods of the the God of the cosmos, right? The God of everything. That's what I think that means. Not only do we see earthly fathers, but we see the example for us. I'm getting tired, so I'm going to have to end this. Verses 10 through 11, second part of verse 10. But He disciplines us for our good, that we may share His holiness. Let me say that again. This is God's word. But He disciplines us for our good. Some people will say, well, God doesn't like me. He allowed this to happen. God loved you so much, He sent His one and only Son. Right? And because He loves you, He allows you to struggle through different things. But there's an example for us. If you're a parent here tonight, and you are wondering if you are disciplining your child properly, I want to remind you, parents, the best example you can ever have is the Lord. The Lord is the example. The way He disciplines us is the way that we should seek to discipline our children. The main part of this, though, is pointing to the fact that we should be thankful for the discipline of God, because the Lord is holy and His discipline is instituted in our lives so that we can be more holy. Look at 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 16. Since it is written, you shall be holy for I am holy. And how can we become holy if God doesn't actually try to make us holy? And He wants to make us holy, but you don't want to be holy. Just being honest. So many of us don't want to live the Christian life like we say we do. See, isn't this why the church exists? Don't we exist so that more people can know Him and have a relationship with Him and become holy? Don't we exist so that more people can run the race for Jesus? Isn't why the church exists? Then why do so many churches look like a social club? Why? Why do so many churches look like an opportunity to just hang out with people? No, guys, we're on a mission. This is a hospital, and we're all to be nurses, right? To serve the sick, to love those. But so often we view becoming a Christian as our going to heaven card instead of a lifetime journey of glorifying God and becoming holy because He is holy. You may be here tonight and you didn't realize that the trials that you're facing could be a part of the Lord wanting to discipline you and mature you. As the writer of Hebrews said in verse 11, for the moment, all discipline seems painful rather than pleasant. But later, it yields the peaceful fruit of righteousness to those who have been trained by it. Discipline is not fun. Discipline does not feel good. But it is necessary in order for us to grow in the Lord in the way He wants for our lives. Let me end tonight with a personal. Randy, if you can, go ahead and cut the video if you don't mind. With a personal testimony. I was in high school, long time ago.